Hi, and welcome to day two of our 10 days of Thanksgiving, or I should say, gratitude. Yesterday, I shared the first prompt, sharing something good that's happened this week, and today is day two. Now, I have made a free journal that you can have for yourself to follow along and to write in, and I'll post a link in the comments that you can go and grab. It's free, it has all the 10 days of prompts that you can do. Or you can just keep following along here on my Facebook page. And please invite anybody who you feel might just need to be practicing some more gratitude. So today's day two, and the prompt was, what do you have today that you didn't have a year ago? Now, I really like this question because there have definitely been times in my life where I have felt like I've gone nowhere and haven't accomplished anything, and that it's all the same. But when I actually take the time to look back and think about what has changed, I can see that I'm not where I was before, that there has been some movement, and most times things have improved. And so, if you're in a space right now where you kind of feel like you're not loving it, be encouraged. Because chances are you won't be in this spot next year. And there's, maybe parts of your life right now where you're not enjoying, but other parts that might be better than what you were happening last year. So I think this is just a really good opportunity to take stock of the things that have changed, how we've grown, what we've acquired or not acquired. Anyways, so my answer is, answers. I have answers to questions I have had for a while now, and I will give you some background information so that answer's not confusing for you. So it's about my middle daughter. She's 8, and when she was in kindergarten, we noticed that she would be just like dead tired, like could hardly keep her head off her plate at the dinner table. Now, having a little bit of fatigue, certainly when you're first starting kindergarten, is pretty standard and normal because kids aren't used to being that attentive all the time. And so there is some transition that happens. But this wasn't the normal into kindergarten transition because September, October, it's normal to see kind of that sort of behavior. But then later on in the year, they should be moving away from it. But we just kept seeing this fatigue happening, and she was getting, like 12 to 13 hours of sleep of like, yeah, hours of sleep a night. So, then we thought, well, maybe she's not getting good quality sleep. And because she was snoring, we decided to wait for a sleep study. It was a while, but we finally got an at-home sleep study and did the test. And it was like a rough night, but we got the info we needed, which was nothing. There was nothing wrong with her airflow, no reason that they could see why she wouldn't be able to have good sleep. And to kind of, there's then a higher level sleep study where you actually go in hospital. So that's a pretty long wait. We actually still haven't, got notice. I'm not even sure if we're even still on that list or not. But anyways, so the next step was to see an ENT specialist. So if you're not in the medical field, that's ears, nose, throat doctor, for like pediatrician for a child. So we waited a while to see him, and they were just checking to see the airflow in her throat and if her tonsils were enlarged and any obstruction that may be causing some sleep issues. But everything was normal. So, at the same time, so now she's no longer in kindergarten, she's grade one. I started to notice that there was a complete disconnect between what I knew she knew and what she was being assessed at. So, I knew that she knew how to write. And had a certain level of what her printing could be. And then she'd bring home her agenda and some of her notes, and I just wouldn't even be able to read them because they were just so sloppy. And then her reading level at home was pretty good, but then when her assessments came in, she was still at a, level A, B, which was behind for her age level. And I just was really confused. I was kind of asking, like, what's going on? Is this like an attention thing? Is she pretending not to know? Like, what is going on? And so that whole grade 1 year, I was just kind of really just confused, not frustrated, just confused. I was trying to figure it out. I didn't know what was going on. And anyways, that summer, I happened to be talking to the about this issue with somebody I knew who was, a psychologist with the schools. And she suggested, well, instead of thinking about it as an attention thing, look at it as an opportunity to connect. And maybe she needs more connection. So when she started grade two, this is last year, it worked out really well. My son's bus came at 8, and the girls didn't need to leave to school until 8:15. So I had a 15-minute window every day that I could sit down on the couch, have her on my lap, and just talk about whatever she wanted. And so it was really nice. We got some really good connection going on. But the issues still persisted. So, not that I thought connection would be this magic pill, but I just thought maybe we'd see some movement on the needle, and we didn't. And so then, life keeps going, and I'm having a conversation with a friend, and she says, "Well, have you ever thought about Madeline having ADD?" And I kind of thought through it, and I wasn't sure because she was my least busy child. Like, out of the three kids, she was never busy. And so stereotypically, when you're looking through all the characteristics of ADD, like, being busy is one of them, and she was not. And I think the other thing that was kind of hard for me was that, like, she could actually sit down and be engaged in an activity for like an hour at a time. And I had never seen that from my other kids. So, I just kind of put that thought in my brain and just let it sit there. And I think it was like that week or the next week we had parent-teacher meetings. And so I brought it up with the teacher. I'm like, hey, maybe she's seeing something I'm not. And so we asked her, my husband was there, and we said, hey, is attention an issue? And right away she's like, yes. So she shared with us some of the things that she'd been seeing in the classroom that we hadn't been seeing at home, because the classroom is a very different environment than the home. So then, we made an appointment with the doctor, went into the doctor, had these conversations. The doctor gave me the forms I needed to kind of fill out. So in Alberta, there's a parent form. There's a whole bunch of questions you go through and answer. It's kind of multiple choice or whatever, fill in. And then you also give a copy, you give a different form to the teacher, and they write some of their observation, and both of you send them to the doctor, and then the doctor decides what's the plan for treatment. So, the teacher was quicker than I was putting in the paperwork, but we both did. And then I had more conversations with the doctor, and she said, well, we find with ADD, we don't know if it works, like if it is it, in unless until they take drugs and it helps, and then we know for sure. So she's like, let's try some medicine. Because by this point, she was middle of grade two, falling behind in her schoolwork. And I knew that if we didn't kind of get some sort of solution, that there'd be longer, educational repercussions in the future. That, those first kindergarten, grade one, two, three are really fundamental building blocks for kids in school. And if they don't do well in those years, it spills over into the other years. And so I really wanted to kind of have answers as sooner rather than later. So we tried a level of medicine for her, and I gave it a couple weeks because you can't really know right away. I mean, sometimes you do, you know, within 24 hours, but other times you don't. So you kind of have to give it a few weeks. And I asked the teacher, I said, "Hey, are you noticing any difference?" And she says, "No." So I was like, "Okay," a little bit worried. But I called my doctor, we upped the dose, and you know, within a week, the teacher was like, "Yeah, I can see she's focusing, she's paying attention, she's working." And I just, so in December, she was reading at a level like C, which is beginning of grade one. And by June, so this is including COVID, she was reading, she by June she was assessed level E. So to me, that was such a big jump that she had made, certainly with all this COVID stuff going on. So I was pretty happy to see that the medicine that we had chosen to give her was helping with her. And then when we had conversations with her, it was never that she was busy in her body, but she was busy in her mind. So the way that she kind of describes it in the language that we use is that she has like 100 stories going on in her brain at the same time. And so the reason why she was able to play for those chunks of time was because she was just like making her own little world. So the world that she had created in her mind, she was just playing it out on her floor with the little people. But of course, when you're in school, that's not helpful and it's very distracting. So, I've just been noticing this year that the treatment that the doctor has given us has really helped with her ADD, and so I'm just really happy. So that's why I say this year I have answers, and I didn't have those last year. So I'm really happy to kind of see the progression that she's been able to do. And I know that she's still behind in her reading levels, but I've just been thrilled with her jump. And even so, she was assessed in September when school started, and usually kids regress in their reading levels. And because there was also COVID, I was really worried that she was going to be like back to level C or D. But her teacher assessed her and she was a level F, like she'd gone up a level, even without really doing much reading at home over the summer. So I really knew that, oh, okay, what we're doing is working and I'm really happy. Now, I know it's not like the magic pill and everything goes away and there's nothing else to worry about, you know, as kids grow, as their brain develops, things change and we'll have to reassess and stuff like that. But for now, I'm just really happy that we have some answers regarding her and what's going on. So, like I said, sometimes we get in places, right? I was really kind of had a lot of questions about her for 2 years. Wasn't really sure what a solution was. And, you know, as we prayed about it, the Lord heard us and he brought people into our lives to maybe even have us think about certain things. You know, have you considered this? Have you considered that? A teacher who had experience with kids with ADD could see it right away, tell us that she'd maybe think it was. A doctor who supported us, who didn't question us, who encouraged us, who heard us. So those are really tons of things to be thankful for. So, in the comments, let me know something that you're thankful for that you have today that you didn't have a year ago.